I'm going to introduce myself. My name is Robert McCaw. I'm the Government Affairs Manager for the Council on American-Islamic Relations. That's the nation's largest Muslim civil rights and advocacy organization. So I'm going to be brief because we're all a little hungry, but I'd just like to highlight a few reasons why there's a need for our communities and our masjids to work together and organize, and why we should be involved in social justice issues. Now, I'm coming at this from a Muslim perspective, but a number of the issues that I'd like to address, they affect all our communities. To sum up my job and my position and my work, it's just to advocate for a Muslim perspective on the policy issues of the day. So whether that's immigration reform, or that's warrantless surveillance, or that's watch list issues, or racial profiling, or anti-bullying legislation, it's to make sure that our members of Congress, that the administration, that they hear and that they recognize and that they listen to the American Muslim community's voice. But really, to be honest, I don't do that job alone. I rely on American Muslims from across the country, from CAIR chapters, from our interfaith partners, from our community allies that have already established those relations, have met with their members of Congress, have met with their local state elected officials, have called the administration, and they've built those relationships, and it makes my job a lot easier when I call an office and they respond to our community's concerns because they already know our community. And that not only works for the Muslim community, but that works for any faith community here. You have to build those relationships so that they might know who you are. So recently, I had the opportunity to join CAIR's 7th annual Hill Day. It was in March. We met with 168 congressional offices. That's one-third of the House, that's a quarter of the Senate, and we discussed issues related to watch list. We talked about how our community's leaders, our community members, that they have trouble while traveling, some of them are grounded. We talked about a number of issues. Some guy over here just might be on a watch list, but that just doesn't mean you can't fly. That means you might go through secondary, third degree screenings that are invasive, and really, they're just based on profiling, whether that's racial or that's religious profiling. One issue in particular to the Muslim community, we talked about extrajudicial exile. What's that? That's when an American Muslim flies overseas to visit their family members or to attain an education, and when they hit the ground, they're placed on the no-fly list, a federal terrorist watch list, and they're not able to travel back home to the United States until they submit to a voluntary interview with the FBI where they're coerced into becoming community informants. Now, those are some really big issues, and those are just particular to the Muslim community, except profiling, which I think happens to a lot of Americans. But we also discussed anti-bullying issues. We talked about how American Muslim children, how Sikh children, how African American children, how children of minority backgrounds are being discriminated against, and there is not federal legislation to stop that. There is the Safe Schools Improvement Act, which would track these events, create statistics so we could know more, but yet it doesn't move in Congress. For racial profiling, there's the End Racial Profiling Act, which would require the police to have at the federal level and states that take federal funds to create policies in which they have to track and record their stops, their investigations, and see if there's a racial religious component to it. There are a number of legislative solutions to the Muslim community's issues and to, I think, the broad American issues that we just all face as interfaith allies, as just affiliates of each other, as neighbors. And so, you know, while these are broad watch list issues, there's really just one thing in particular. When we met with these congressional offices, there were a select few that really understood what the American Muslim community was experiencing. And so, I'm just being shown some time, but really what I'm trying to get to is, while some members of Congress understood those issues that affect our community, that are our community allies, the vast majority were not even aware. They're not aware of what's happening and that they need to be educated. Now, they were friendly enough to open up their offices to CAIR, but more needs to be done. More needs to be done at the local level. I embrace the idea of thinking local and acting local. And that means making friends and making allies with the people that are elected to your city's council. That means getting in touch with your local state representative. That means getting involved, having your children or yourself volunteer for electoral campaign and backing a candidate that reflects your views. It doesn't have to be a Democrat or Republican. It has to be someone that's just doing what's right and that you agree with. And so all of politics is based on volunteers, votes, and money, and we have to be contributing something. And I just hope, you know, as local grassroots activists, sometimes we don't always have that money, but we have those votes, and that we need to let our politicians know that we vote our minds and we vote our hearts and we vote our conscience, and that's where we need to be. And there are a lot of issues that are affecting the Muslim community and other minority communities and interfaith communities across the country. And I ask for your help and that your support.